have Dr. Vikram Jaggi with us, who's going to speak about enabling and empowering patients. Dr. Vikram Jaggi, medical doctor, who's going to speak about enabling and empowering patients. And I'm happy that he's speaking about this because one of the big things which I think this country needs again is taking the best practices from the West, is we need to promote patient advocacy. So Dr. Vikram Jaggi.
I'm sure most will say that doctors don't listen. I can see smiles there. Doctors don't give them enough time, and doctors don't give explanations. It is true, and there are reasons for this. Traditionally, our medical system has been very paternalistic. I am the doctor, I know best. I have given you the orders, just follow them. Don't ask questions, don't waste my time. It used to work. Infections, events in the life of a patient, where explanations and teaching is not that important. All is important is the doctor to be able to diagnose and effectively treat. Today, many changes have taken place, two changes mostly. One, chronic diseases are far more common. Diseases which are not going to go away: diabetes, allergy, asthma, blood pressure, heart disease, cancer. So you are sitting with a doctor for only 2, 3 minutes, maybe 2 or 3 times in a year. Rest of the time, a diabetic has to manage his own condition. So the role their conditions well. Secondly, the cultural and political change. People are no longer happy just following orders. Authority figures just giving orders and expecting people to follow them, that's not our culture anymore. So things have to change if you have to effectively treat chronic diseases. This I learned 20 years ago when I got interested in asthma. To accept that you have a problem, you have to expect it's going to be there. You have to learn to manage those things themselves. You have doubts, worries. These are steroids, these are inhalers, these are habit forming. They have to be removed. So how did I do that? What was the challenge? The challenge for a doctor is doctors have very little time. So they have very little time with their patient. One patient. And teaching would involve half an hour, 45 minutes. But then you can't say there's no solution. So what I found and did was have educators in the clinic. I taught 2, 3, 5, now we have taught about 20, 30 people whose job is to coach patients, make videos, write small booklets which are easily understandable. Technology helped. You can now have webcasts spread over a long range. You can talk, sit here and talk to 50 different centers where patients are listening to you. I made a website which patients can visit and understand. So this is how I started doing this. Patients then become very, very good in managing their disease. My very old receptionist once told me, "Doctor, you're doing a very foolish thing. You're making them your patients so good they don't come now to you. They don't come and pay you your fees." Similarly, when I talk about these things to doctors, they say, "You are talking very lofty ideas, it's not practical." But I think it is practical, it's not lofty at all. First, the pure joy of helping somebody. And even from a financial angle, if you're doing a good job for one patient, okay, so what if he doesn't come back soon? He'll send 4 more new patients. What's the problem? There is no problem at all. The two keywords given to me were enabling and empowering. Applied to patients, are they different? Yes, they are, a little bit. Enabling, just teaching them to manage their diabetes, for example, or asthma, for example, how to take the syringe, how to use the inhaler, etc., etc. That's required, but that's not a very lofty goal. A loftier goal would be to make them part of taking medical decisions. every medical aspect treatment has got pros and cons. Nothing is straightforward. If you use a medicine, you're getting something, but if you are getting some side effects also. Things are different for different people. They hold different things important. You have to involve them. That is enabling patients. That is empowering patients, actually. One question came to my mind when I was thinking what I'll be speaking here. Can all patients be empowered? Some people think that people from the rustic background or who are not intellectually very, mostly they can be. Everybody is sensible enough to know what is good for him or her. However, culturally, sometimes there are difficulties. A few months ago, one old patient of mine who lives in the city got his mother from the gaon for me to see her first time. She's an old lady, 70, lived in the village. So she came and after the hello, I said, so Mataji, what is the problem? What is your problem? You know, this is the first question a doctor will ask. I asked, Mataji, aapko kya takleef hai? So she looked at me and said, to ye to tum boojho, tum doctor ho. So her expression was that you were saying he's a good doctor, intelligent doctor, but he seems to be like an idiot. He's asking me. He doesn't know his job. So there are still people like that who can't comprehend this involvement. They like to be led. They shy away from taking this responsibility because along with the empowerment comes the responsibility of taking whatever has been decided by the doctor and the patient. So not everybody can be empowered thus. And another interesting thing is, people say that they want empowerment. Patients want to be involved today in the decision-making process. But when it comes to the crux, what happens? I had read a study come out from Mayo Institute long ago. It was very interesting. They took 100 women, normal women, 45 to 55 years of age, and asked them a question. Suppose you were to get breast cancer. Would you like your doctor to decide your treatment, or would you like to be part of that decision? Mastectomy, chemotherapy, radiotherapy, these are all very important things, destructive things, disfiguring things. Almost everybody predictably said, of course we would like to be part of that decision. How can we entrust the doctor alone with that decision? Simultaneously, in the same era, they took 100 newly diagnosed patients of breast cancer and then asked them the question. Surprisingly, a majority shied away from taking that decision. They said, the doctor knows best. Let him decide. And we doctors face it every day. When we even explain to patients that, how should you like me to treat you? Some people get involved, and some say, some are very baffled by this question, as if the doctor is not confident in himself. And some then will say, we leave it for you to decide. Oh, fine, there's no problem there. We leave it for you to decide. So the doctor has not only to be a good diagnostician, to be able to diagnose the condition, but also a good diagnostician, how much empowerment to give to which patient. So in that lies actually the art of medicine and the joy of medicine. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Jaggi. I'm so happy to see a doctor, ethical doctor, who wants to actually promote patient advocacy. I don't think too many doctors want to do that because it's not good for the business model, right?
Hello, doctor. My question is, do you also take the role of a psychologist while treating the problems of the patients?
I personally don't, but there will be certain fields where that kind of help will be very, very much required. See, what is psychology? A doctor is dealing with a doc. I won't fall down. I won't fall down. It's just tantalizingly close, but I won't fall down. A doctor's job is actually, over the years, to understand the psyche of the patient. So he becomes a fairly good psychologist, psychoanalyst, and psychotherapist. A person who is intelligent, not a doctor, but intelligent and is keenly interested in the human mind, how the mind functions, can do that job. In fact, I have trained many simple boys in my clinic who are hardly, you know, at 12th pass, given them the empowerment, do good to these patients, they will feel so happy with the results that they will call you Dr. Saab, which they do. When they come to the clinic, they praise more those boys than me, because actually those are the ones who are directly helping them.
Yes, Hari Singh ji.
My name is Hari Singh. I am activist for HIV positive peoples of India. मैं कहना चाहता हूँ कि जो ट्रीटमेंट एजुकेशन है वो हर व्यक्ति का राइट है कि उसको ट्रीटमेंट एजुकेशन मिले, क्योंकि जो भी दवा मैं खा रहा हूँ या जो भी खाता है तो उसका हक है कि वो अपने शरीर पे उस दवाई का दुष्प्रभाव या उसके साइड इफ़ेक्ट को वो जाने, जिसकी बहुत कमी है प्राइवेट हॉस्पिटल्स में भी, गवर्नमेंट हॉस्पिटल्स में भी, और ट्रीटमेंट एडहेरेंस की भी बहुत कमी है कि जो दवाई लोग खाते हैं, फॉर एग्ज़ाम्पल लाइफ एच आई वी एड्स के अंदर लाइफ लॉन्ग ट्रीटमेंट खाना होता है, ए आर टी ट्रीटमेंट जिसको हम कहते हैं, तो उसकी एजुकेशन और एडहेरेंस की बहुत कमी है. दूसरा टीबी की दवाइयों का भी बहुत एडहेरेंस की बहुत कमी है कि लोगों की जो निष्ठा है वो दवाई के प्रति नहीं होती. ट्रीटमेंट लिटरेचर की बहुत कमी है हमारे यहाँ पे. ट्रीटमेंट लिटरेचर डॉक्टर नहीं देते, गवर्नमेंट भी नहीं जल्दी देती कि जो ट्रीटमेंट वो खा रहा है उसके दवाइयों के नाम क्या हैं, उसके साइड इफेक्ट्स क्या हैं, किस किस दवाई का कॉम्बिनेशन क्या है. टोल फ्री हेल्पलाइन हमारे यहाँ पे नहीं है कि कोई आदमी टोल फ्री हेल्पलाइन पे जानकारी ले ले किस डिजीज़ के बारे में मुझे पूछना है, टीबी, एचआईवी या कोई और शुगर है या कोई भी बीमारी है. डाइटिशियन की एक बहुत बड़ी कमी हमारे देश में मैं देख रहा हूँ, तो इसके लिए मैंने काफ़ी एडवोकेसी भी की कि डाइटिशियन इंपॉर्टेंट है, क्योंकि दवाइयों से इंसान सिर्फ जिंदा नहीं होता, एक पौष्टिक आहार से भी जिंदा होता है, क्योंकि जो हम खाना खाते हैं, भोजन पानी पीते हैं, उसका एक बहुत ही इफेक्टिव रोल
सर,
दवा में है.
सवाल सवाल क्या है सर?
सवाल यही है कि जो क्वालिटी प्राइवेट हॉस्पिटल्स में है वो गवर्नमेंट हॉस्पिटल्स में नहीं है, चाहे वो काउंसलिंग को लेकर है, चाहे वो ट्रीटमेंट को लेकर है. प्राइवेट प्रैक्टिशनर में बहुत ही कॉस्टली ट्रीटमेंट होता है, हर आदमी बिलो पॉवर्टी लाइन उसमें नहीं जा सकता. फेक एंड क्वैक
सर, द वन बिग क्वेश्चन फाइनली, तो एक बड़ा सवाल, नहीं तो पूरी कहानी बोल देंगे हम. सवाल का जवाब डॉक्टर जी देंगे.
ठीक है,
तो आपके आपके जो पॉइंट्स आपने खड़े किए हैं वो बहुत अच्छे हैं, बड़े अहम पॉइंट्स हैं. उसमें से एक को लेते हुए ये तो सारी चीजों की बड़ी जरूरत है.
मैं फील कर रहा हूँ कि फेक एंड क्वैक प्रैक्टिशनर जो है, झोला छाप आज हमारे देश में बहुत बढ़ते जा रहे हैं, जो लोगों की जान के साथ खिलवाड़ हो रहा है, वो एक बहुत बड़ा इशू है, जो कि इलिटरेट हैं और सिर्फ मनी मेकर हैं और आयुर्वेद या एलोपैथ दूसरी पैथीज में प्रैक्टिस कर रहे हैं और लोगों की जान से खिलवाड़ होता है, वो एक बड़ा इशू है.
Are you in sync with nurse practitioners? And if so, do you agree with that?
It is a wonderful concept, because the patients still feel very hesitant coming out with the doctor. When they find that authority figure, which of course is being eroded, but still an authority figure, they don't come out with the truth, their own actual fears, etc. Number one. Number two, when they find that the doctor appears to be very rushed, they are not going to open up their deepest recesses. So we do have that kind of a thing in our clinic, where such different kind of things come out which we could never imagine. So I am totally with you that the visit to a clinic should not be waiting for 1 hour and sitting with the doctor for 5 minutes. It should start when you enter. There should be something in our clinic. I would invite you to come to my clinic sometime. There are videos playing about educational matters. There are literatures in different languages. There are 3 or 4 people who are moving around asking, what can I do for you, in a sense, and making groups of patients talk to each other. So every possible way, and believe me, patients who come for a problem to the doctor, they would far more do all of that rather than just waste their time looking at Filmfare or Femina, which they can do at the barbers also. So I am totally with you, because this has to be done, otherwise it's not possible. How can a doctor single-handedly do all
that?
Yeah,
but that's against government. So I'm wondering whether a couple of you all can get together for a policy change.
Yes, yes, I'd love.
Thank you, Shyamala ji, and more offline. We have Ranjit and Roshni standing there. You are starting to ask questions. Yeah, you have some questions, but keep it crisp. Just keep the question very short and, you know, articulate the question. Yeah, please.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Actually, being a father of 2 small daughters, I have this question. Actually, I was in 2 locations, one in Faridabad, now I'm based in Noida. Now, I had 2 different doctors treating my daughter, and the approach was totally different. One was using, because she had some problem with asthma and all, so one doctor was giving constant, very frequent antibiotics, while the other doctor uses very less antibiotics. Maybe in a year's time, he has used once or twice. So my question, and I came to learn that the use of
antibiotics... Please speak into the microphone.
Yeah. I came to learn that the use of antibiotics is actually harmful. So I love the way this Noida doctor is treating my daughter. But my question is, like, I learned it the hard way. Now, could I have got a way to know this beforehand, or could I have been enabled to know this?
Absolutely. But don't depend on that for the doctor alone. You have to get off the butt also. You see, when we are talking about empowering patients, the patient also has to get off his knees and get off his butt and start working. Your daughter has asthma. It is your responsibility to read up about asthma. And once you do, you will get so much knowledge about asthma that a bad doctor will not be able to badly treat you have to disallow that.
Right.
It's possible. When you take your car for service, if somebody says, okay, you have the petrol, this, that, you first read about it before you actually invest in that. So why not in your health?
Right. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Jaki. We have the young leader, Mehul, giving away the certificate. Thank you so much. Thank you, sir.